It's great to see so many of you here again. We were here almost exactly 5 years ago for the launch of Born to Run in this exact same spot. But judging by the London Marathon, which I had the misfortune of running last weekend or a couple of weekends ago, we've done a pretty awful job of bringing much natural movement back to the world. And Nike are still selling a lot more shoes than we are. The transition is tough, but as many people here can attest, it's worth it. A full rebooting of your movement hardware and software doesn't happen overnight. And thanks to the inspiration of Born to Run and luminary coaches like Lee Saxby, for some of us, movement and running has become fun again. Although if Lee were here, he would tell you how he runs an hour a day with gaffer tape mouth like a kidnap victim. For reasons you'll find out all about in Chris's new book, i.e. staying in the fat-burning pulse zone. Still, the last 5 years have been extraordinary for us. VIVOBAREFOOT launched as a standalone brand in 2012. We've sold over 2 million pairs of shoes, opened 20 experience stores, created 300 coaches, thousands of instructors, all promoting natural, healthy movement. We've also helped spawn a dedicated educational and research organization run by Lee called Born to Run. We've worked with Bushmen in the Kalahari, two bands of ancient cobblers in North and South India, and the Sami reindeer people, who have all demonstrated more perfect biomechanics and near-perfect barefoot shoemaking. For example, the Sami reindeer boot moccasins made from hock below the knee are 50% lighter and 50% warmer than the most advanced technical hiking boot on the market today. They've been making them for thousands of years, wear them with no socks and just a little bit of hay for insulation, and they keep your toes completely toasty at minus 30 degrees. The Sami now have started wearing more fashionable shoes from the south. And there's now an old wives' tale in Lapland that when your back or your knees are hurting, if you go back to wearing the traditional reindeer hock moccasins, you'll feel fine again. We're learning more and more about ancient wisdom every day, and are more committed than ever to help reboot the shoe industry back to its natural origins. And it's all in no small part to this man, who has inspired a generation to rethink the padded hegemony. Chris brought a lot of people together for us, people we met for the first time in this very hall 5 years ago, and we still work with today. And I'm sure there are new friends here tonight that we look forward to working with for the next 5 years. I've already just been hearing about ideas for the next book. Anyway, congratulations on this book. It's really cool to know that back in 2011, when we were all fawning over Born to Run and figuring out posture, rhythm, and relax, Chris was slinking off to Oxford to meet the other Chris and work on this very book. This book could not be more timely for us. We're aiming to inspire people to get back to nature, leave the beaten path, and blaze your own tracks. Reconnect with your childhood and your natural potential. Reconnect with yourself. It's with really great pleasure that we welcome Chris back to Conway Hall to inspire us all again to fuck exercise and love moving. And we're happy to be with this man doing all we can to bring natural, healthy movement back to the world. A revolution is afoot, or as if you haven't read the book yet, you'll know what I'm talking about later. As IP Man might have said, a one-inch punch is a big toe. Chris is going to compare this evening, and so he'll introduce all the wonderful acts that are going to go on today. There's loads of beer. Have fun, have a party, and enjoy the night. It's Chris McDougall.
That I automatically feel outgunned, especially because he already dropped an F-bomb in the first 5 minutes, and usually that's my job. As you can hear, I've got about 7 minutes of talking before my voice leaves entirely. Thank you, London weather. So I'll do my best, and if anybody in the back, well, actually, I was gonna say raise your hand if you can't hear me, but that's the way it goes. We have a lot of beer here tonight, and the whole thrust of this event is to make it not a talk, but like a party. So at any point, forget your manners, go outside, grab yourself a beer. Ordinarily, we tell you, like, turn off your cell phones, turn them the fuck on, call your mom, live tweet, do whatever you want. So if you want to videotape with your hand in the air, be right ahead. You know, this, the idea is to have fun, have a good time. Don't just feel like you're stuck in your chairs. You know, years ago, I used to do this thing in my talks where I would say, you know, if Phil Knight wants to win a Nobel Prize immediately, all he has to do is put a running coach in every major city in the world and just teach people how to run properly. There are millions of people injured from running every single year, and that injury rate has remained unchanged for 30 years. So if you can turn that around, if you can cure running injuries, bring movement back into people's lives, the repercussions are almost unfathomable. You know, if you get people to no longer be afraid of running, to actually look at it as fun, because, you know, pain is a deterrent. It's how you train animals not to do something. You cause them pain. Running is deterred by pain. If you remove the pain from running, then suddenly millions of people are going to be out there having fun like five-year-olds. So I used to say, Phil Knight, take a tiny slice of your profits and teach people how to run without pain. He hasn't done it, but Galahad has. And I don't think you guys can appreciate, or put it this way, it takes me some thought to appreciate exactly what he's done. He's committed himself to doing something that nobody else in the world will bother with, because selling shit is fun, but teaching people is hard work, and it takes a lot of commitment, and it's been years later. And the fact that he's still doing it, I think, is remarkable and says a lot to his real dedication to something that the rest of the world is turning their back on. So Galahad. And I must say, Nike has never invited me into a hall to give a talk. I probably have to thank a lot of other people, and I'll get to them later, I guess, because I'm kind of forgetting right now. But I do want to just point out, my publisher, Profile Books, right from the get-go, have always been, basically the reason why I can't talk right now is because of them. Every time I'm here, from the second I get here, they sort of treat me both like family and also like a herd animal, which has like to be run from place to place as quickly as possible. But that's a sign of a truly committed publisher. And again, a big part of the reason why you're all here right now is because of Profile. They brought this book into the world in the UK. They've been enthusiastic fans and supporters ever since, and I am deeply grateful to them as well. So Profile, wherever you guys are, thanks a lot. All right. So. Enough of the gratitude and on to the stuff. This book was something I didn't expect to do. It came out of a couple of weird incidents. And one of the first of them took place in a schoolhouse near my home. This is more than 10 years ago. I'd heard about this, and it was such a strange incident, I actually went to check it out for myself. There's a schoolhouse out in a rural cornfield. It's called Rising Sun Elementary School. And the school teacher, the principal, was a woman named Norina Bensel, a woman in her 50s. Never been in a fight, of course, in her life. And again, the schoolhouse is very isolated, surrounded by farms in all directions. And one day, Norina was in her office looking out the window, and she saw a guy like sort of fumbling with the door, trying to open the door. Obviously, he didn't know the security protocol. He didn't know he had to buzz himself in. And she got up to see what he wanted, and as she was getting up, she saw a mother and a daughter come to the door, and they were buzzed in, and this guy slipped in behind them. So Norina went down the hall to find out what was going on, maybe needed some help. And as she approached him, he pulled a machete out of his pants and came after her. And what happened next was remarkable for a lot of reasons, but when you hear the story, it's easy to chalk a lot of what happened next up to luck or accident, but Norina made a series of rapid-fire life or death decisions that really made the difference between her dying and a lot of other children dying and surviving. So when this man began to attack her, keeping in mind, nobody ever expects a person to pull a machete at them in the morning, particularly a 50-some-year-old woman in an elementary school. What Narina did was she raised her arms in an X fashion like this, and she began backing away, leading him away from the classroom toward her office. I always have trouble telling this story. I vowed I would never do it again, but it's a good one. So she led him away from the kindergarten back to her office. Meanwhile, he's hacking at her the whole time, chopping up her arms. When she got to the office, she slipped inside, bolted the door, and then called for the secretaries to put the school into lockdown and call the police. So the alarm goes off, the classroom goes into lockdown, the police are summoned, but they were like a second too late. The kindergartners were already leaving the classroom, already coming out in the hall. So when this guy confronts a locked door, he turns around and he starts heading back toward the kids. So Narina leaves the safety of her office and goes back after him. Now, that's just one thing I think you can meditate on forever. Someone who opens a door and goes back out, where she's pretty sure the result is not going to be good. So she goes after this guy again. He turns on her again and starts coming after her with a machete, and once again, she's leading him back down the hall. At the point where she starts to collapse, her arms are so chopped up, there's so much blood leaving her body, she falls to the floor. He turns around again to go after the kids, and at that point, Narina springs up and locks her arms around him from the back in a hug and holds on. And something about that, the way she turned herself into a human lasso, was tight enough where he dropped the machete on the ground. And then someone else ran out, grabbed the machete. And at that point, he gave up the fight. The police came roaring in, took him away. They got her in the hospital in time to save her life, get blood back into her body. They were able to reattach her fingers and suture her arms up. She's lost a lot of sensation in her arms. She has these long scars up and down her arms. But she's back in the school. No one else was harmed except her. And when I went to that school to talk to her about it, it was just so gratifying to go out in the playground with her and realize all these kids were out there because of her, because of what she did right. And I wanted to know, like, was it an accident or was there something we can learn? Is there something we can reproduce from what she did? And one of the first things she said to me was, I don't consider myself a hero. And I thought, how detached are we from this word if you confront a guy twice, who's twice your size? Oh, I forgot to mention, this guy was a former soldier. You confront a soldier with a machete twice who tries to kill you, and you save the lives of how many children, and you immediately say, no, I'm not a hero. Well, then who on earth is? And that's what got the wheels turning in my mind. I feel like we've gotten so detached from what the word means that we don't even understand what we do it ourselves, if we fit the category or not. So there were a couple things Narina was doing. Again, she had a lot of different options. When he went after her with the machete, she could have turned around and started screaming. She could have fallen to the ground. She could have begged for help, but she didn't. She did one thing, which was to keep eye contact and back away and keep moving her arms from side to side to deflect the blows. There's no way that someone of her stature and size can go up against a former soldier muscle to muscle, so she didn't. What she did was wrapped her arms around him and locked her hands, using all that elastic, fibrous tissue in our body known as fascia to turn herself into a human lasso. And later on, when this guy was on trial, and before he was about to be sentenced, they put Narina on the stand. And she said, she turned to him and said, I was trying to comfort you. And he said, I know. And I think the reason why he stopped fighting, even after he lost the machete, was there was something about that hug that changed his circuitry in his mind. That the act of aggression he'd begun with was short-circuited by the fact that she had this instinctive compulsion to show compassion as opposed to showing aggression. And I think the reason why she was able to do that was because your amygdala, that part of your brain that prevents you from trying new actions, that sort of preventative mechanism in your brain which urges caution before you try something new, that's the reason why it's very hard to ride a bicycle at age 5, but really easy at age 6, because until you've tried it once or twice, riding a bicycle, your brain is telling you, no, this is dangerous. You're off the ground, you're not balanced. Once you do it, and your amygdala realizes that this is a safe behavior, from that point on, it will just sign off on it, no problem, go ahead and ride the bike, we know it's not dangerous. For Narina, fighting, punching, hitting, these are foreign actions which her brain would not sign off on. But the act of hugging, that was very common to her, it was very normal. So when she got the inspiration to hug this guy, her amygdala signed off on it and said, yeah, go ahead, we know what hugging is, go ahead and do it. So all those things, the fact that she maintained eye contact, that she deflected, that she chose to hug as opposed to fight, I think those are the reasons why she took a potentially or definitely lethal situation and was able to save a lot of lives. So, you know, I thought about this for a long time. I thought, yeah, but, you know, how do you learn this? Like, how do you learn? How did she know? Something inside her had been trained to do that. It couldn't have been an accident. So I started going to search. Well, you know, what is the nature of heroism? Where can we learn it? How can we, the rest of us, learn how to be Narina Bensels? And where it took me was a direction I didn't expect. It took me back to something I'd heard about early in the stages of researching Born to Run. You know, when I began researching Born to Run, I wasn't a runner. I didn't really know much about running at all. I was intrigued by the Tatamata Indians. And the simple question is, you know, how is it these Indians can run 200 or 300 miles at a time at age 70, and I'm like in my 30s, and I'm getting hurt all the time, and I can barely run, and I need special shoes. But these guys are wearing these like funky sandals, and they're doing it at 70, 80 years old. So what do these guys know that the rest of us don't? And so, and since I didn't know anything about running, I was kind of throwing the net really wide and researching everything about running I could possibly find. And one of the things I came across was a reference to a guy called the Cretan runner. And I thought, okay, so this must be some really kind of cool Greek marathoner. But it turns out it was the wrong kind of runner. He wasn't a racer. He was a foot messenger during World War II. So, okay, this doesn't really apply to Born to Run. So I kind of put it aside. But then later on, when I was wondering this question of how Narina Bensel was able to perform under those circumstances, I sort of made this connection. Like, I wonder if this Cretan runner guy, like, I wonder if there's something happened during the resistance that could sort of tie in with that story and be a window into understanding Narina Bensel. So I'm back into the Cretan runner research. And again, I found a story that I'd never heard of before. And I think a lot of us had probably never been exposed to it because, you know, history is written not just by the winners, but the winners with the most guns. And so, you know, the history of World War II is really written by the big armies, the military forces. And what we forget is there are lots of people in small places making decisions and doing things which were instrumental and actually changed the entire course of the war. It was not always about the invasion of Normandy and, you know, the flight from Dunkirk and, you know, and the Maginot Line. There were lots of other smaller incidents which were pivotal to the defeat of the Third Reich. And one of them had to do with the Greek island of Crete. In fact, it might have been one of the most pivotal moments in the entire war. So here's what happened. This Cretan runner I was talking to you about was a guy named, well, let me start somewhere else. So here's what happened on Crete. When Hitler started pushing west at the beginning of World War II, what he confronted were armies which had spent the previous 20 years devoted to one thing and one thing only, keeping every goddamn German in Germany. That's all anybody had focused on since the end of World War I was preventing a World War II. So when Hitler started pushing into Poland, he's running up against concrete trenches and razor wire and tanks and cannons, everything pointed directly at him to stop him from spreading west. Every major army in Western Europe devoted to one thing only, and that one thing was Germany. And those defenses were, as you know, amazing. They held up for like 25 minutes. And from that point on, it was just a glory ride heading due west. I mean, Hitler defeated every major army, 9 armies in a row, one after the other, in a matter of months. Every single place, once the army was crushed, that was it. The population was subdued and conquered, because what else are you going to do? If they beat your army, nobody's going to run out in the street and try to fight back. So once the Germans ran through Poland and through Amsterdam, through the Netherlands and through Belgium, that was it. The army was defeated, the population was subdued. There's only one exception, and that was the Greek island of Crete. When the Germans invaded Crete, it was the only place in the world where the resistance began immediately. So here's what happened. You know, once Hitler had, you know, conquered the mainland, all he's got to do now is get Russia, and he wins. War is over. Once he's got Russia, then he can come back here, finish you guys off, because you guys are on the ropes. There's no way the U.S. is going to get involved. Why the hell would the U.S. get involved once he controls all of Europe? There's no reason why the U.S. needs to be involved. So all he's got to do now is get to Moscow, knock off the Russians, and he wins. And that was a pretty easy job, because the Russian army was terrible. The Red Army was a disaster. Stalin figured that any general who was strong enough to actually lead the army was also strong enough to knock off Stalin. So he kept knocking off his best generals and putting these like political stooges in their place. So the Red Army was a disaster. All Hitler has to do now is like time things perfectly. All he's got to do is get in there before it snows, knock off the major cities, and he wins. But the only thing you got to do before going to Russia is get control of Crete. And for one reason only, Crete's not really particularly important. It's just a rock in the middle of the Mediterranean. But why it's useful is because it's that little stepping stone across the creek. You know, you step on Crete and then you move on to Eastern Europe. So Hitler looks down at Crete and he realizes, oh, you know what? The army has already been evacuated from the island. They're not even here. This island has no defenses. It's a small island. So you say, you know what we're going to do? We're going to send a shitload of paratroopers in, 24 hours. We lock down the island, and then we're making a beeline straight for Russia. So that's what he gives the command. He tells his generals, 24 hours, lock down Crete, on we go. So if you were a Cretan in 1941, and you're in your kitchen making breakfast, you would have noticed that outside the sky suddenly got very dark. And you look out the window, and what you were going to see was literally 100,000 German paratroopers coming down from the sky. This was the largest aerial invasion in military history. They went in with overwhelming force. The idea was come in hard and fast, subdue the entire island, and move on. So that's when the Cretans had a decision. You can either do what everybody else did, which was like let them come, or you can rush out spontaneously and fight back. And that's what they did. So if you're that Cretan in the kitchen, you dropped the spoon, you grabbed a steak knife, you stuck it on a broom, and you went out there to fight. I mean, these guys were pouring out in every direction. I mean, imagine right now, if we heard a bomb blast outside, I highly doubt that all of us would react the same way. You know, we'd be sort of heading different directions. These guys, as a unified body, were out the door. And I'm talking like old ladies, monks. Monks were some of the toughest fighters of the war. These monks would have these like big swords, ceremonial swords, hanging over the altar. These were grabbing these things off the altar and running outside to fight. Monks, old people, young people, out there fighting in the streets. They were so effective that that 24-hour deadline came and went, and Germany still could not control the island. That was day one. Day two, three, four, five. Day five, Hitler sends a telegram to General Kurt Student and says, France fell in 5 days. What's happening on Crete? At that point, Student took out a pistol, and he put it next to himself on the table, deciding that if he could not conquer Crete, he's going to have to do the honorable thing and take his own life. So for the next 5 days, he kept that pistol on the table next to him. 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 days it takes Germany to finally get control of only the perimeter of Crete. The mountains are still full of bandits and outlaws and resistance fighters up there fighting in the mountains. So that was the scenario. So now Hitler has had it with the guys with the steak knives. So he sends an order and he says, I want you to control that island with extreme brutality. No Geneva Convention, no rules of war. You see anybody doing something you don't like, you put a bullet in their head. You see any village that shows any signs of any bullshit, you burn it to the ground and you kill every single man in that village. Those were his orders. And to make sure they were carried out, he put this guy in charge of control of the island. That is General Friedrich Mueller. The thing around his neck you probably recognize is an Iron Cross. Not many people have one of those. To get an Iron Cross, you've got to be an extremely hard, tough guy. You've got to be the cream of the German military establishment, and you have to have served with distinction on the battlefield. General Friedrich Mueller had served with honor during World War I, top military school graduate. He's one of the best that Hitler has. He was so effective on Crete that he soon won a nickname. He was known as the Butcher of Crete. But he wasn't going to be unchallenged. Even though he was the top of his class and an extremely brutal ruler, he had his opposition. Because up in the mountains of Crete was this guy. That's George. So George was a shepherd, fifth grade graduate. Had a nickname as well. He wasn't known as the butcher. He was known as the clown. Some of his hobbies were playing pranks on his friends and writing poems like his epic work, Ode to an Ink Spot on a Teacher's Skirt. So George was kind of actually pretty representative of the people in the resistance. He had no military training, he didn't even have a gun. The only thing he could actually do was run really far. So he's the guy who became known as the Cretan runner. This is the guy I first heard about. And his job was to run messages back and forth through the mountains. So these resistance fighters didn't have radios or walkie-talkies. The only way they could communicate was by giving a message to George, and then George would give it to somebody else. So Galahad, so you said you ran the London Marathon. Did anyone else run the London Marathon recently? Yeah? Pretty hard? Pretty long? Did it look like this? So when I say this guy's running messages, he's not just like delivering them next door. He's literally like starting up here and then taking a message. Like they would decide, you have a resistance up in the mountains up here, and they say, all right, tomorrow morning at dawn, we're gonna attack the Germans. And George would go, okay. So he'd run down here and up over here, and he'd say, okay, tomorrow at dawn, we attack the Germans. And they would say, dawn's a little early. Tell them 10 o'clock. All right. How's 10? 10's good. 10's good. But I'm messing around a little bit, but literally what this guy would do is go through these mountains for 50 miles at a time, deliver a message, wait for the reply, turn around, run back, give the reply, confirm the reply, and turn around and go back again. Back and forth 3 or 4 times for every single operation. Meanwhile, keeping in mind the thing I said earlier about the butcher of Crete, saying anybody you see gets a bullet in the head. So it's not like he's following a really nice laid out route like you guys have for the marathon with like Gatorade and like Cliff Bars every mile. This dude is literally grabbing shit off the ground and stuffing it in his mouth as he runs. And the places he's running are places where you really hope Germans will not be. So any place there was a trail or a road, he can't go. He's got to be on the most inhospitable terrain up and down over rocks. So you got to stop and ask yourself, how on earth is this physically possible? How do you run for 2 days through the mountains nonstop with no caloric energy at all? No food, no little silvery blanket at the end to keep you warm. There's one account I read of George. He lived for 3 days on a diet of boiled hay. There are no calories in boiled hay. It's basically, it's just brown water. So clearly he's doing something different. And that became my real fascination was, it's either one of two things. Either this guy is some kind of like Wolverine, X-Man, mutant freak, or he just learned something that the rest of us haven't learned. And what I discovered is on Crete, it wasn't a coincidence that the Cretans, first of all, instantly sprang into action, and secondly, that they would know the kind of stuff that would allow them to physically respond. Because what happened on Crete was not only the birthplace, but the incubator of this long-lost art of the hero. See, you know, we have this notion now where heroes are these sort of exceptional beings that somehow emerge from the smoke with your kitten in their arms after your house is on fire. You know, we don't know who this guy is or where he comes from, but luckily he was there. But you know, the Greeks didn't have that luxury. They couldn't just hope that somebody was going to show up at the right time. Because you know, we have the luxury now of removing all the emergencies from our lives. You know, if your house is on fire, what do you do? Call the fire department, right? If someone steals your car, what do you do? Call the police, right? You call somebody else. We don't rely on our friends. We rely on our phones. I mean, we're at the point now where we don't even play our own games, right? We hire people to go play football for us, right? And then we hire somebody else to bring a cable to our house so we don't even have to bother going to the game that we're not playing. And then we call somebody else to bring us food to eat while we're in our house watching the game that we can't even be bothered to go to. We outsource everything. But the Greeks didn't have that luxury. On Crete, there was no standing army, so everybody was considered a soldier. There were no schools, so everybody was considered a teacher. There was no police force. Everybody was a policeman, which is a beautiful, harmonious sensation, unless, of course, like your neighbor is a shitty fireman. You know, if you're relying on your neighbor to help put out your fire, and he's like, oh, you know what? I just got these shoes. I really, you know, I don't want to get them wet. Or the guy's, I don't want to fight. You know, you have to get your own car back. It doesn't help to rely on people if those people are unreliable. So what the Greeks decided was, look, we can't hope that the right guy shows up at the right time. Why don't we just be practical and make sure that everybody is qualified to respond? And so what they did was, again, we come from the starting point that someone like George has got to be exceptional. And they went from the starting point of like, look, you know what? Let's just look at the stock parts. Let's just look at the lowest common denominator of what everybody has. Take that lowest common denominator and just like buff it up a little bit so it can actually perform exceptionally. So what they looked at were, what are the natural movements and skills that everybody has, and how can we elevate them a little bit? And that was the starting point. So the first thing they looked at was strength. Now we've developed this notion of what strength is, that it's based on size, right? The bigger you are, the stronger you are. We've seen guys like Arnold and The Rock, and they're huge, and these, you know, ultimate fighting champions, and they're gigantic, they're muscular, really big guys. But this notion of size equaling strength is a brand new concept. It's new to our lifetime. It only began in the 70s with the advent of that little independent film called Pumping Iron. Have you guys seen Pumping Iron? see it again. If you haven't seen it recently, it is amazing. It is like the craziest semi-porn psychodrama. It's a bunch of dudes in their panties and oils, just like scheming behind each other's backs and like, you know, getting all catty with each other. But besides like this bizarre little like, you know, naked frolic, it was also the first time any of us saw people of that size before. Humans had never existed of that size before because the drugs never existed before. Pumping iron is the first indication on film of what you can actually do with elite chemical German engineering. These guys were pumped full of artificial testosterone, and it created a human that was bigger than anybody else. But it also created a way of exercising, which was brand new, which is the idea of isolating muscles and doing this until the muscle tears and it fills with blood and it swells up. So you go to any gym in the world today, I guarantee you'll see someone doing this, right? Do you know why? Like, you will never do anything in your life that involves this motion. It's not even effective for eating. You know, you're kind of like. So what it does though is it damages muscle, it tears it up, it isolates muscle. And again, this idea of isolating, tearing, breaking down, and increasing in size, that's new to our lifetime. If you were a hunter-gatherer, like the last thing you wanted to be was really big and injured. If you're big and noticeable and injured in the jungle, you're also something else. You're lunch. You're food for somebody else. So we've created this notion about size equals strength, but the real notion of what size is really all about was very different back on Crete. So, I mean, you have to ask yourself, if you were in a life and death situation and you wanted someone to come to your rescue, do you want the big muscular guy or do you want guys like this?
Thank you very much to the guys. My name's Dan. I do parkour. I'm a director for Parkour Generations. It's basically a fancy way of saying that I jump off shit for a living. Kind of like those guys.
So first of all, I want to do a little thought experiment with you guys. So I'd like you to stand up. All right, so the interactive part would be like... what I'm going to do is to sort of think about your daily life in the city. Most of you probably live in an urban environment now. Most of you do. So I want you to think about your daily life. And think in terms of how much your movement varies throughout your life, okay, throughout your average day. So think that in terms of linear movement, like walking, sitting, you know, maybe running for a bus, sitting at your desk or whatever, that's not very varied, right? It's pretty routine linear movement pattern. To being really crazy and lots of different movement, like this sort of stuff you saw here, really varied movement patterns, sort of natural functional movement skills, okay? So if your movement is quite linear, I want you to put your hands quite close together, okay? If your movement is like that and you do parkour for a living, you can have your hands out here, okay? Or anywhere in between, depending on how much you think you get variety in your day. Go for it, okay. So I'm just gonna take a photo of that. Hang on. Okay, you sit down. Thank you very much. Keep that in mind. Okay, I'm going to send a quick text. I'm going well, standing ovation.
There is a point. And the point of it is to get us to think about how much we move, okay? How much we really move. Because now in the lifestyles we lead, okay, they are extremely sedentary. If you look at the stats, the amount we sit down, it's huge, right? Absolutely huge, the amount of time we spend either sitting at a desk or watching TV. And if you think about the routine of what you do every day, if you really think about it, like, how much do I vary that routine? Most of us, you know, we get up, we have breakfast or whatever, we go to work and we probably use the same route to work that we use most days, okay? Most of you probably do, right? So either the same trip via tube or car or, again, when you're sitting down, right? Or standing at best. Get to work, you work, and then go to lunch, probably the same route to lunch and go home, probably the same route, you know? And every now and again, it's going to vary slightly with a different type of evening, or maybe you do a bit of sport here and there, maybe a couple of days a week of sport in the evening, or fitness if you go to a gym. But it's really punctuations to a very sedentary lifestyle or a lifestyle that's exceedingly linear in its movement, okay? And that is not how the body is designed to be. It's not how we evolved, okay? So parkour, if any of you don't know, who's heard of parkour, sometimes called free running? Wow, look at that. Like, if I asked that question 10 years ago, like, hardly any hands would have gone up, okay? It would have been maybe a couple of people, maybe. But it's come a long way, okay? And it's this seemingly superhuman movement discipline, okay? So you had a little demonstration from the guys up here, which was great, and they did a great job. And you kind of look at, a lot of people will look at that and we think, wow, it's amazing, you know? Those are kind of elite level athletes, and all the guys you see on YouTube, it's like, well, they're superhuman. Those individuals are just special. Yeah, well, they're genetic freaks in some way, right? But the truth is, actually, what parkour is just returning us to the way we should be. Okay, that potential, that movement potential, is what all of us have. It's not superhuman at all. It's just human, decidedly human. But we just don't reach that potential anymore. Okay, and for us, that is a better definition of strength, is to reach your full physical and mental potential through movement, through overcoming movement challenges and adapting to terrain, than how much weight you can lift, how much you can squat, you know, all this kind of stuff, how big your muscles are. It's a better definition of strength because it's more holistic, right? It's more useful, it's more effective. And the point of the body is to get from one place to another, it's to get the brain around. That's the evolutionary purpose behind the body, is to keep your brain safe, away from predators, and to get it from A to B, so it can you know, do its thing and plan how it's going to reproduce, I guess, in the end. But it's very much about moving yourself over terrain, adapting to terrain. And how much do we do that now? Okay. Even our training paradigms, our exercise paradigms in the gyms, they're not that way, right? They're very linear, they're very isolating, the movements, as Chris said. And they don't really challenge your body in that adaptive sense at all. Very few of them, okay? There's a slight change coming. And things like Chris's book are a big part of that change, I think. So it was really cool when Chris asked us to be involved with this and came and spent some time with us training in parkour and learning about that so he could introduce it in the book. And as he came to understand, as he trained with us, that actually it's not superhuman. It is just human. When I started sort of 13 years ago, I was already been training in fighting arts and martial arts since I was really young. So I thought I was pretty strong. I thought I was pretty fit. I thought I had good balance. You know, I thought I was pretty capable. And I'd mastered fear in that kind of sphere. I suppose I was okay at kind of combative situations and didn't really scare me anymore. So I thought I was pretty capable. And when I came across parkour, I was lucky enough to come across some of the French guys training and spend some time with them. I realized that, you know, I was really a baby in terms of movement and strength and fitness and capability. Really, that I couldn't do 10% of what these guys could do. And at the time when I first saw it, I wouldn't have believed it if someone had told me about it, if I hadn't have seen it. You know, then when I saw it in my eyes, I was like, okay, so humans can do that. And it seemed superhuman. But then I was kind of stupid enough to train with those guys and push myself to try and understand it and realize that actually over a little bit of time later, okay, I can kind of do it. And realize that actually it is our potential. We just don't explore it, okay? So, and how does that tie in with the book? Well, it ties in because parkour is a modern iteration of what we're all capable of. And it's been throughout history, humans have been doing this stuff, as you saw, as Chris explained with the Cretan runners. They've been doing this stuff, and you know, we've been strong and fit and capable long before we had gyms. And parkour is just a modern iteration of that. It's a modern sort of showcase of that and a modern way of training to get to that, to get to that stage, to get to your sort of true mental and physical potential. So it's a real pleasure to be here on the book tour and to work with Chris. And you know, really, thanks very much to Chris for bringing us into this and to Vivo for putting on such a great night in Profile Books in such a great space. And if you haven't read the book, I hugely recommend that you do, okay? It's going to be really, really important in helping people understand that there is this potential within us, and the movement skills, the movement potential we have are huge and varied, not just about running in a straight line. And, you know, it's going to, we want that. We want to start people's minds just getting around that and restoring movement to their life as much as possible. So if you haven't read it, do read it. It's absolutely awesome. And I'm going to bring Chris back on right now. So, Chris.
So I need to embarrass somebody tonight. Shirley, would you mind standing up for 1 second? So this is Shirley Darlington. If you haven't seen the video Movement of Three, it's got like 60,000 views on YouTube. I think 59,000 are just mine watching it over and over again. But Shirley was actually one of the people who coached me in an all-women's class. If you ever have an opportunity to take a class with Shirley, anybody at Parkour Generations, do yourself the treat. It will just change everything. So I just want to publicly thank Shirley for everything she did for me. She's fantastic. So the reason I started thinking about parkour in the first place was, you know, I was on Crete and I was watching people move through the mountains, and the way they're moving was this thing known as the Cretan bounce. There's this very light, bouncy gait that Cretan shepherds use when they're running through the mountains. They look a lot like a fighter in the ring, you know, just bouncing, 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 really light and smooth. They go up and over obstacles kind of flowing across them. And I'd seen some parkour videos, but I didn't really know what it was. And then one day, I was at near my home in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, and I was like looking out the window. I was in the checkout line, and I saw some dudes like kind of flying through the air over the railings. I thought, oh, that must be parkour. So I sort of bought my stuff and went outside, and I asked them about it. And they said, yeah, you know, we're training in parkour. And I said, can you guys teach me? And they're like, well, actually, you're in the wrong parking lot. You want to go to London, you want to go to Parkour Generations, and that's where they had been trained. So that's when I contacted Dan and Shirley, and just to find out more of what parkour was all about. So what you saw right there, to me, is a much truer definition of strength. So I started digging back a little further to find out where parkour came from. And what I discovered was there was this whole legacy of natural movement dating back much earlier to an incident that happened off the island of Martinique early in the 1900s. There was a French naval officer on a troop ship off of Martinique when the volcano began to explode. This guy's name was George Hebert. So George Hebert hops into a lifeboat and he starts steaming towards shore to try and save people's lives. And what he saw around him was horrifying because tens of thousands of people are dying right in front of him because they can't handle a couple of basic human movements. Things that every other animal can do without a thought, but these human animals couldn't do anymore. They couldn't swim a few yards offshore to escape. They couldn't climb up a rope to get into the boat. They couldn't pick up like a 40-pound child and carry the child to safety. So instead of running away, they're wrestling with this 40-pound child. You give them a 40-pound box, no problem, right? Easy. But you know, bodies are sort of awkward. They don't have handles and they're hard to pick up. So George Bear is looking at this thinking, what has happened to human beings which make them incapable of just saving themselves? This was not difficult movements, but for some reason, most of us just can't do them anymore. And so, you know, he went back to France and he thought about this for a while and he began to test his friends. He began to test his fellow naval officers to see whether they could do these basic things, like can they get themselves up off the ground? Humans used to be great climbers. Most of us can't climb. We can't get up a rope. We can't climb up a tree. He thought, can they throw? Can they catch? Can they defend themselves? Can they pursue? Can they crawl? Can they run? Can they hike? And what he found is across the board, even naval officers who were supposed to be ready for action at all times, out of the 10 basic human movements, they would fail on at least half of them. And he understood why. And the reason why is pretty simple. Because you take any 5 or 6-year-old, and most of the time, what you're telling them is, stop doing that. Get down off that. Stop kicking your sister. Stop fighting. Stop running. Sit down. Sit down. What we do is we take these very healthy animals that spend all their time practicing survival skills, because that's all it is. All they're doing when they're fighting and running and jumping off shit and climbing on shit, all they're doing is practicing normal animal survival skills. So we take this kid at age 5, who knows exactly what he needs to do to survive, and we take that kid and we sit him down and we put a book in front of him and say, now don't move for like 15 years. And as soon as you finish that, we're gonna put you in another chair over here and stay there for like 25 more years. You spend your entire life sitting down, trying to turn yourself into this like cerebral being, forgetting the fact that we are actually creatures of movement. And that becomes the challenge. The challenge becomes, well then, you take that creature and how do you rewild it? So, let me see how I should do this. I'll just go right to here. So I've one of two ways to go. I'm trying to figure out which one's the best way. Let's go to Tara. So, I was gonna do the other stuff, I'll do it later on. So one of the people I found who's been doing this for the past 15 years is Tara Wood. She basically created a company called Wild Fitness, which is dedicated exactly to that art of taking us sedentary human animals and learning how to rewild them. So here's Tara.
Thank you. Okay, good evening everyone. I'm glad I was the best way that Chris chose. And I would have leapt up here, but it would just have been awful if I'd tripped. So it's awesome to be here tonight, and particularly because there's so many friends from Wild Fitness here, people I didn't know were gonna come. And so I'm really grateful that people from Amman, from Kenya, from New York, from Cheltenham, from all over the place. And it makes it feel a lot more friendly to be here. So thanks for being here. So I'm Tara Wood, and my whole life I've had this desire to be wild. And I founded Wild Fitness 15 years ago, and we run holidays all around the world. We teach wild movement, wild eating, and wild living. But what do I really mean by this word wild? And I want to start by telling you a story that a friend of mine, Erwan Lacour, told me. And Erwan is a natural movement teacher. He's a key character in Chris's amazing book, and he's also someone we've drawn a lot of wisdom from our teachings in Wild Fitness. And what he used to do is he'd take his friends to an enclosure in Paris in which they kept wild wolves. And he would take with him a hunk of red meat. And he would put this hunk between his teeth. And then he would put his face through the fence into the enclosure on the other side. And he would wait. Now, if I did that, I'd be terrified because the fear is that this wild beast is going to come and rip off your face to get at the meat. But what happened was, before he even realized, a wolf had come and whisked the meat from his mouth with such precision and such speed that it had felt as gentle as a kiss. What it was efficient, purposeful movement. And Erwan had had an intimate encounter with animal athleticism. And it's this kind of wildness that I want to talk about today. So now if you take your imagination to your local gym and imagine the kind of workout that you might behold there. So people sweating and grunting on the bench press machine and pounding on the treadmill. And you might be forgiven for thinking, you know, well, maybe we've lost our wolf-like abilities. Maybe us modern humans, we're just not naturally graceful. But is this true? And something extraordinary that I witness at Wild Fitness makes me believe that it isn't true. Our inner wolf is still intact. And this is what I've noticed, that if you give your body the chance to do what's natural to it, if you give it the chance to do a movement whose purpose it understands, it becomes immediately nimble. And a good illustration is when clients come on a Wild Fitness course, when they first arrive and you watch them run, they can look quite heavy, quite uncoordinated. It kind of looks like it's just their mind that's pulling their body along and their whole body is in deep protest. I know you've seen people run like that in the park. And if you get a frisbee and throw a frisbee and ask them to run and catch it, immediately, they're nimble. Immediately, they're athletic. They're wolf-like, even, in their movements. And it's not just with running that this kind of immediate transformation happens. It's with climbing, it's with lifting, it's with jumping, all these other natural movement patterns. After just a few days of wild training, there's a radical improvement. So how does that happen? Doesn't it take time to build muscle? How can it happen so immediately? And the reason is because what we teach is actually to ask people to stop overusing their muscles. And we ask people to try to use the free forces that are available to us when we move. Does anyone know what these free forces might be? Apart from the Wild Fitness people, not allowed to answer. Anyone know what free forces we might use when we're moving that not our muscles? Gravity. One other. What'd you say? Momentum, that's kind of the same as gravity. The other one is elasticity. So we use gravity and we experience that as our body weight, and elasticity is, you know, storing in our elastic tissues energy and then reusing it. So what we do is we actually, with natural movement, is we minimize the use of our muscles and we maximize those free forces, which is why when you get it right, it feels effortless. And it's also why anyone can do it. Doesn't matter if you're a man or woman, you're big, you're small, you're young, you're old, anyone can do it. So our bodies, it's natural to our bodies to be efficient, to be useful. But what about our brains? What is natural to our minds? And this is where I think the fitness industry or mainstream fitness has really let us down, because a lot of what the fitness industry uses to motivate people is to ideas about changing the way they look. And this human instinct to, I guess, to want to be accepted or admired is strong enough to get people to sign up to the gym. It's strong enough to get people to buy all the fitness kit in the fitness magazines, but it just doesn't last. And after a few months, people inevitably usually give up. And so this is where what we call the wild mindset is so magical, because this is an approach to fitness that inspires you for life. And what it does is it taps into these very powerful, deep human instincts. The instinct of survival, the instinct of pleasure, and the instinct of purpose. So the instinct of survival, it's this kind of delight that your body feels when it's ready for all sorts of eventualities, when it knows that if it has to, it can escape, it can chase, it can push, it can climb. And there's a kind of calmness or a confidence that you feel when you know you can do these things. And the next thing is to consider pleasure. There's an inherent kind of motivation when you're doing something that you enjoy. But when you're doing something you enjoy, it also really impacts your performance. And there's a story that I want to tell you about a friend of mine called Roger, who I met in Dahab in Egypt when I was freediving last year. And this place, the Blue Hole in Egypt, it attracts some of the best freedivers from all over the world. And they train really hard. They train for several hours in the day, and they're super fit. Now, Roger hardly trains at all. And he's sort of in his 60s, he's quite overweight, he's quite crippled in one leg, and yet he dives to world record depths. He can compete with these other athletes. And I asked him what his secret was, and he said, okay, well, Tara, the first thing I do is I have a gin and tonic a few hours before I dive. And the second thing is, I wait for a few hours before I go, and I sit in the cafe next to the Blue Hole, and I listen to Elvis songs. And then when I feel like it, I go diving. And then the third thing is, I only do one dive a day, and I make sure that I really enjoy that dive. So what he'd done was he'd been really disciplined about associating diving with joy and relaxation, which is really important for freediving. But it's also really important for all kinds of movements, including running. And Chris explored that beautifully in his last book, Born to Run. So this amazing reward that we feel when we start training in natural movement, it's tapping into our instincts for survival and pleasure. But also, there's this other higher instinct, which I hadn't really thought about, or I hadn't thought about it as much as I have now that I've read Natural Born Heroes, and it's really sort of blossomed as a beautiful idea, which is that we're tapping also to this instinct of being purposeful or wanting to be useful and be able to help. And there's a story which Dan told me, which is a beautiful story about a colleague of his called Andy Pearson, who's a senior parkour coach. And the other day he was standing on the underground platform, and a man next to him who'd drunk too much fell onto the tracks and passed out. And at this moment, the lights turned green, so everyone knew that a train was going to come within a minute. And everyone froze, except Andy, who jumped down on the tracks, picked the guy up, put him on the platform, jumped up on the platform, got on the train, and went home. So was Andy braver than everyone else? Well, maybe, but the fact is that he knew that he could do it. He was totally capable of doing it. It was absolutely within his physical ability. And it probably wasn't with anyone else. And if everyone else had felt, had that natural ability to do that, they probably would have done it too. So even if you never get the chance to use your natural movement to save someone's life, it still feels wonderful to know that you can. So I want to leave you with a question. Would you prefer your fitness to be a boring chore that makes your body less intelligent? Or would you rather take the sort of wilder route? And would you like to embark on a lifelong, joyful journey that makes you stronger, makes you more skillful, and makes you more useful? So I hope that after tonight you take this more wilder route. I hope we've inspired you to do that. And I hope maybe we'll see you some of you on our holidays. We run holidays in Crete, in Zanzibar, in Spain, Isle of Wight, and in London. And we're running a coach's training at the beginning of next month. And I hope you also read Chris's book, which is amazing. It's going to revolutionize fitness. I'm so glad to be here with him. And thank you very much. Good night.
Are you guys all on a beer run, or are you heading home? Beer run? Yeah, to remind you, these guys didn't need to be reminded, but there's plenty of beer outside, so follow this gravy train just right out the door right now. And so while you guys are stocking up on beers, there are two things that Tara said that really stood out in my mind. Number one, like someday I can tell a story that begins with someone I met in Egypt while I was freediving. And the second thing was the reward we feel when we do something purposeful. And like, to me, that's what this is all about, you know, that we do this stuff and we wonder why we do it. You know, we run the treadmill, we do the elliptical, and at some point you have to say, is this useful? Does this serve any purpose at all? And the test of whether it's useful comes back to where we started on Crete in the first place. So here you have this guy, George Sikandakis. You have the resistance. They're up against 80,000 German soldiers who've been ordered to put a bullet in their heads if they take one step out of line. So what do you do? How do you actually resist a force like that? And what they did was something very similar to Narina Bensel. They looked at what they had and said, rather than try and meet these guys muscle to muscle, let's meet them brain to muscle. Let's look at the resources we have, the natural movements, the natural skills we have, and see if we can devise a plan that can make these guys stumble. And what they came up with, to me, is just one of the most beautiful movements of the war. They came up with this idea. Like, you know, we're never going to beat 80,000 of these guys, but maybe we only got to get one of them. Maybe all we got to do is grab the butcher, make that guy disappear. We don't kill him. We grab him and make him vanish off the island and pop up somewhere else. Because if you're the other 79,999 Germans and your general has suddenly disappeared from Crete and popped up in Egypt and you don't know how the hell it happened, you're going to be looking over your shoulder the rest of the war. So that was their plan. And it was a really bad plan. And there's a reason why no commanding general had ever been kidnapped from the field of battle before. It's just too hard. It's too stupid. You know, you don't try and capture the king in your first move in a chess game. Because the reason why is you lose all your pieces, right? You don't throw your very limited manpower up against 80,000 guys with guns trying to get past them to capture the most protected guy on the island and then go back past the 80,000 guys again to get to freedom, only to remember we're on a fucking island. There's nowhere to go. You're just running in circles. But that was their plan. That was what they were going to try to do. And to do it, they're gonna have to do more than run. They're gonna have to tap into these skills that Tara was talking about, these natural movement skills. And so some of the things they were doing too were these things that Georgia Bear noticed before too, these skills of run, walk, and hike, throw, defend, climb. And so what I became intrigued by was, okay, if these are actually natural movement skills, then they have to be natural for everybody. A movement isn't natural if it only pertains to part of the population. So if humans had these 10 natural movement skills, everybody should be able to do them, old and young, male and female alike. So when you start to tick them off, you're like, okay, run, walk, hike, everybody can do that. Defend, pursue, everyone can do that. Jump, land, everyone can do that. Then I came to one that was really problematic, and that was throwing. Because we know that there are certain people who can't throw. Who are those people? You can shake your head all you want, but say it. What's that? Would you say it in the microphone?
Do I have to?
Who can't throw?
Women.
Okay, I did not say that. She said that. Women can't throw, which really throws things into disarray, because if you accept that notion that women can't throw like a girl, well, then it really disrupts the entire natural movement theory. Because here's the thing about it is, throwing isn't just one of the 10 movements. It is the movement. It is the most important movement in human history. Even more important, I dare to say, than running. Running was pretty good for a long time. Running allowed us to survive on the planet as persistence hunters, but it was throwing that allowed us to dominate the planet. As persistence hunters, we could chase animals to death and, you know, gather the caloric energy from their carcasses. But that was just basically catching an animal once in a while. Once we went from being persistence hunters into being throwing artists, suddenly that transformed everything. When we were able to pick up a rock and pick our quarry and hit it with that rock, suddenly we went into a whole different category as hunters. And the thing about it is, it's one thing to pick up a rock and see an antelope and hit the antelope with the rock. It's another thing if the antelope has other plans for the afternoon and sees the rock and decides to take off. Because at that moment, you got to pick this rock up and instantly calculate a ton of variables really quickly. You got to figure out like weight and texture and size, speed, velocity, force, wind, elevation, its velocity as well. You got to calculate all these variables, and then you got to do the thing which is hardest of all. You got to do something that creates a whole different form of thinking, because you got to throw the rock not where the animal is, but where the animal isn't. You got to basically project into the future. You got to create a reality in your mind that doesn't exist yet on the planet. And that was the first act of creative imagination. You saw something in your brain before it actually happened. And we're the only creatures that can do that. We're the only creatures that have creative imagination. We're the only ones that can throw with force and accuracy and hit something. And once we mastered that skill, everything changed. It was the most important technological innovation in human history, bar none. Way more important than calculators and computers and telephones, all the rest of it. That moment when we learned to think into the future, that allowed us to create literature and language and technology and architecture. I mean, engineering is seeing something in your brain that doesn't exist yet and then figuring out how to make it happen. So the most important movement in human history, and I'm sorry, who can't do it again? Women, okay, women can't do it. So that's why I started to research. Well, what's the problem here? If you get this reward, as Tara points out, the reward for doing something purposeful, then what are we depriving ourselves of if half of the species can't do something that was the most important movement in our history? So I started looking into the art of throwing, and I came across a couple things which are kind of cool. First of all, does anybody know who has the world's record for the most consecutive free throws? Thank God, because I really want to answer the question myself. It is not an NBA player, it is this guy. Let's see if I can find him for you. Where is he? Not her. Yep, hang on. It is this guy. So that is Dr. Tom Ambury. He's a 71-year-old retired podiatrist. He had spent so much time in podiatry that he never exercised at all. So when he retired at 70, he was so out of shape he couldn't actually play basketball anymore. So all he did was shoot free throws. And he became kind of intrigued by the art of free throws. He's like, well, you know what? In surgery, my goal was to do the surgery as efficiently and quickly as possible, because the quicker you get a guy off the table, the quicker and the better the chance of recovery. So He thought, well, if I can figure out how to shoot a free throw the way I operate surgery, there's no reason why I shouldn't shoot perfectly all the time. So it took him about 9 months of going down to the court and just studying the art of throwing a basketball. At the end of 9 months, he set up his automatic retriever. He called a guy from Guinness. They opened up the gym at 8 o'clock in the morning, and this guy began to shoot free throws. He shot until 8 o'clock that night when the guy who ran the gym said, well, you know what, it's time to go, turn off the lights. At that point, he had shot 2,783 consecutive free throws. Now, the NBA record for most consecutive free throws is 96. So you'll notice this is an old guy who had never played the game in 50 years, and yet within 9 months, he had mastered and perfected it. And he actually began to teach other people. Now there's scores of people in the US that can shoot almost perfect free throws all the time. So there we've conquered the element of age, but how about like females? Why is it that females can't throw? Then I came across this woman. This is a middle school science teacher in Florida named Colette. That's Colette working off some stress after a school day. This is Colette when she's stuck in the kitchen doing dishes. So a couple things you notice. When Tara was talking earlier about rewilding, that satisfaction, the reward you get from doing something purposeful, you notice Colette is pretty chill, man. She's like kicking her leg and flipping the hair. She's laughing, she's smiling. She's not even thinking about this. She's not even aiming. The knives are flying right toward the target. What she's tapping into is something known as instinctive aim. And this was something else that was on display on Crete. One of George Sigandakis' friends was a guy named Kosti Patarakis. And Kosti Patarakis did something which some of the resistance fighters would later say was the most dramatic incident they'd seen in the entire war. And what happened was this. The Germans went into a village looking for weapons. And when they got there, they didn't find any weapons, but they also didn't find any men. So they gathered all the women together and lined them up against the wall of the church and said, where are the men? Where is everybody? And the women didn't talk. So they put a machine gun in front of them and said, okay, you have 5 seconds. Either tell us where the men are or you're dead. And he began counting down. So the German commander begins to count down. He goes 5, 4, 3. At that moment, at 3, he fell down dead with his head blown off his shoulders. What had happened was Kosti Patarakis had been in a neighboring village and he'd heard about the German search. This guy grabs a gun, an old weapon from World War I with no sights on it, and he begins to run at a dead tear through the woods. He got within a quarter mile of the village. That's when he saw the hand in the air with the fingers coming down. And when you have a German commander with his hand in the air with fingers coming down, you're pretty much sure what's going to happen when he gets to zero. This guy drops to a knee. Now keep in mind, it's an old gun with no sights, and he's been running as fast as he can from another village. His heart's pounding, he's breathing heavily, and you know, this guy can take aim from that far away and with one shot, blow this guy's head off his shoulders. That's what instinctive aim is all about. We have this notion, again, that all these skills are very hard to figure out, and we have to work and develop these strange things that maybe some people are good at and some other. But what the Cretans realize is it's all hardwired inside of us. Any one of us could become that Colette and get the satisfaction of tapping into that ancient throwing art. So now I'm going to try a demonstration with Allie. I'm going to try and show Allie how she can become as lethal with a knife as Colette. Up here, Allie. Up you go. I chose Allie because she looks so content over there with her beer in her hand. Okay. So here's a real simple thing. Here's what we're going to do.
When she was using her hands, her touch, her fingers, I cannot shake her off at all. She's in there. Where do my hands go? On it. When we separate her a little bit, her eyes are breathing involved, suddenly she can't process it. She loses that one quick second of contact where her fingers are actually telling her mind what to do. The inside idea that aim is all about swinging down and looking, but actually your fingers are hardwired into your brain to know exactly where it wants to go. If I ask you to point to my head, where's the screen? Okay, where's the mirror? You automatically know where to go. So again, it's how idea of growing. And the reason why it's been cut off from most of the population is we've taken and give a round of applause to Ali.
We take this fundamental act of throwing, and first of all, we've denied it to half the population by not giving them access to organized sports. And the second thing we've done is we've turned a lot of things we used to do instinctively and turned it into recreational activities limited to only a few people, because it's much more lucrative, it's much more easy to capitalize on something when you persuade people that other people do it better, and that rather than doing it yourselves, you should watch other people do it. So one thing I highly encourage you to do is an experiment I started doing after I watched the Colette video, was just get some knives out of the kitchen. And just, I got some pieces of cardboard. And the idea of instinctive aim, again, we have this notion of throwing that it's like from far away and should like swirl through the air and flip. But you notice all what Colette was doing was just extending her body really far and just flinging it like this. So I got, you know, the cardboard and the knives.
Now, I encourage you guys in your kitchens to just grab the stuff, wherever you have your kitchen.
So where this left me by the end of this exploration was, by the time I'd recreated this kidnapping on Crete, this wild run through the mountains of Crete with a band of resistance fighters with a surly German general in tow being pursued by 80,000 pissed off soldiers, where it left me was with a couple different conclusions. First of all, this idea that much like running, we've convinced ourselves that we are much weaker than we really are. But when we actually tap into these movements, we actually realize that we are way more physical, way more resourceful, way more adaptable than most of us have ever realized. And the second thing was, it opened my eyes to something I'd never considered before. And it's this, that moment when the Cretans were called upon to respond and they instinctively poured out the doors, it wasn't just an act of bravery. Bravery is not the issue. If you don't know what to do, that takes bravery. But if you know what to do and you're practiced, it doesn't take bravery at all. And that's what the Greeks were all about in the first place. You know, bravery is for the ignorant. Competence removes bravery and courage from the equation. And that's the thing we should all be striving for. I mean, we hope that the emergency never comes along where we have to respond. But even if it doesn't come along, isn't it just satisfying to know all the time that you're useful, that you're prepared? And it's that kind of feeling that you're ready, that you're useful, that you don't have to be brave because you're prepared and you're useful. Like, that's the thing we should be striving for. And that one time, when the Cretans had to put it to the test, they succeeded so remarkably that when General Wilhelm Keitel was put on trial for war crimes at Nuremberg, before he was taken out and hanged, they asked him if he wanted to make a final statement, and he said yes. He said, if it wasn't for the resistance on Crete, I wouldn't be sitting here today. Other people would be sitting in this chair. It was because of the Greek resistance that we lost the war. He didn't blame Hitler, he didn't blame Stalin, he didn't blame Churchill and Roosevelt, didn't blame the invasion of Normandy. He blamed the fact that the Cretans held up the German war machine so long that by the time the Germans finally got to Russia, it was too late. The snows had fallen, German army got bogged down, and they lost the war. If the Cretans had not held them up so long, it is really intriguing to think about what might have happened. It might have been a whole different outcome in Russia, which could have been a whole different outcome from the war. So as guys like George Sigandakis, the Cretan runner, who, hang on a second, to this day is still memorialized on Crete for what he did. That simple guy, the goofy dude with the funny grin, writing the poems to the school teacher's skirt. But 60 years later, he still remembered for just that one thing he was able to do was respond in a crisis with the thing that he naturally was able to do that he'd been practicing all of his life. And when it came time, he was able to respond. So it's with that message, I just want to thank you all again for coming out tonight. There's plenty of beer outside. And if you guys want to ask us some questions, we'd be happy to answer them. Thanks very much.
Question time.
Yeah. Okay. You guys?